Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to this early morning session of day two of the IISD Trade and Sustainability Hub, which focuses on the WTO's negotiations on rules on fisheries subsidies. And my name is Alice Tipping, and I lead work at the IISD on a number of trade and sustainability issues, including work on fisheries subsidies. Now, when we originally designed this session, we expected to be able to give you, if not the final result of these negotiations, at least a good, juicy update of how the final trade-offs between ministers were going. This has been an issue at the top of the trade agenda for a while, and just before this week's planned ministerial, the chair of the negotiations had in fact released an almost final version of the new treaty text containing the last few brackets for ministers to decide. Now, every day produces a new development at the WTO, and particularly in the coronavirus pandemic. You'll all be very much aware that last Friday, this week's ministerial was postponed because of travel restrictions that had been implied that day. But on Monday night this week, the chairs and co-chairs of MC12 wrote to all ministers indicating that they propose to hold this meeting in person in the first week of March next year, conditions permitting. So we now have another finish line for these negotiations, but one that's hopefully not too far in the distance. So this discussion, I think, is still one about the meaning and the importance of these negotiations, but it's also one about what happens next. Now, research has told us consistently that many kinds of subsidies can undermine the sustainability of fisheries. Those, like subsidies to fuel in particular, that increase fishing effort and capacity beyond sustainable limits tend to be particularly harmful, particularly risky as a policy choice. So the deal that is still on the table in the WTO aims to curb subsidies where they can do the most harm, right? Where stocks are overfished, where, for example, where subsidies are provided on the unregulated high seas, where there's no effective management in place, and also aiming to particularly curb subsidies that contribute to overfishing and overcapacity, which is essentially part of the original mandate WTO ministers set for themselves back in 2001, but it's also crucially a specific target in the UN's Sustainable Development Agenda, that's target 14.6. So we have two crucial mandates to respond to in these negotiations. And those mandates, of course, have not gone away. So the first part of our discussion this morning is going to focus on the rules themselves, what they mean, why they matter, and in particular, why these negotiations are an important litmus test for the WTO's ability to respond to sustainability issues. But of course, negotiating the rules is just the beginning. Somebody described it to me the other day, once you finish the treaty, it's sort of the end of the beginning. The implementation of the rules, when they're finally agreed, is what is going to lead to real changes in subsidy policy and real impact in fishing communities. But implementation of treaties, we all know, is not always easy. The text that's on the table here is short, 8 pages long, it's relatively simple. But at its heart, what it requires is governments to understand and assess the support they provide alongside the fisheries management measures they have in place, right? It requires, in fact, a domestic conversation about policy coherence, right? It's not just a ticking box exercise. It's actually an ongoing process of ensuring fisheries management and subsidy fiscal policies are coherent. And that's more complicated than it might sound. Which means that working through these new rules, establishing whether you're compliant and ensuring you remain compliant may require some help. Now, several partners in and around this negotiation have been working together to build a toolkit to help developing countries to understand, excuse me, and to work through the new rules, working out, to help them essentially work out what they need to do to become and remain compliant with their new obligations, and also to help them, crucially, articulate where they might need assistance and support to achieve the reform that's required. So we're going to hear from some of those partners today. I'm delighted to introduce our panel. We have Isabel Jarrett of the Pew Charitable Trusts, who many of you will be aware have followed and supported these negotiations over many years with an inestimable degree of patience. A particular shout out to Isabel because she's joining us live from Washington, D.C., which means it is 3 o'clock in the morning her time. I'll be delighted to welcome, I think he's here, Ambassador Mikael Anson, who's the permanent representative of Sweden to the World Trade Organization, obviously directly engaged in the negotiations. And also, we're delighted to have the Swedish government as one of the partners in the work on technical assistance, this toolkit. I'm also delighted to welcome Maren Headley of the Caribbean Regional Fisheries Mechanism. We've been working for Maren for many years. She's been directly involved in the negotiations already, understands them very well, and of course brings a very specific perspective of somebody who works all day, every day, with the fiscal and the scientific aspects of fisheries management in the Caribbean region. So we'll be interested to have her perspective on the tool that we're developing. And I'm also delighted to introduce somebody who may not be as well known in the fisheries world, but Gustav Brink, who leads Trade Remedies Unlimited. It's a trade law consultancy based in South Africa, and he has been crucial in supporting the creation of this toolkit alongside my colleagues Christian Irschlinger and Jeva Badarskaite. So the first part of this conversation essentially is more about the negotiations and the importance of the deal on the table. So I might perhaps start with you, Isabel. Thank you again for waking up at 3 o'clock in the morning. But could you give us your perspective on what's at stake in these negotiations and what change a successful outcome could bring to communities and to global fisheries resources? Go ahead, please.
Thanks, Alison. Good morning. I think good morning, maybe good afternoon to some of you. I'm not sure where everybody is. I'm delighted to be here today. As Alice said, my name is Isabel Jarrett and I lead the Pew Charitable Trusts project to end harmful fisheries subsidies. And we've been working with IISD and with others for many years now to try to support members to deliver an agreement. So Alice, the short rhetorical question, if I might be so bold, to what's at stake for global fisheries and fishing communities in these negotiations is what's not at stake. But more seriously, let me provide a few figures that sum up the enormous benefits that a healthy ocean and in particular healthy fisheries provide for us to sort of set the scene. So firstly, all life on Earth is supported by the ocean. The ocean produces half of the oxygen we breathe, so absolutely critical to life on Earth. Second, we depend, as is worth stating, but as everybody knows, we depend on the ocean for food. For many of us, it's a luxury that we enjoy, but fish is the main source of protein for billions of people around the world. And third, jobs. An estimated 250 million people around the world are engaged throughout the fisheries supply chain. So it's really important for livelihoods. But as you indicated, the ocean faces unprecedented man-made crises that are threatening its ability to provide for us. Now, arguably the greatest threat to marine biodiversity and to the ocean is man-made overfishing. Just to give you a sense of the scale of the problem, today more than one third of global fish stocks are classified as overfished by the UN Food and Agriculture Organization. And another nearly two thirds are maximally sustainably fished. So they're sort of pushed to their maximum limit, what they can maximally sustainably produce. In the 20 years since negotiations on fisheries subsidies have started, that proportion of overfished stocks has risen from one quarter to today's more than one third. So in these years that members have spent negotiating, the situation has only got worse. And one of the drivers of overfishing is, of course, harmful fisheries subsidies. Each year, governments provide $22 billion, according to estimates, in harmful fisheries subsidies. We're pushing our ocean to the brink, we're depleting resources on which humans depend, and we're spending taxpayer money to do that. There's some irony in there, I'm sure. And of course, if you're familiar with the topic, but maybe if you're not, for those of you who have not, Alice mentioned fuel subsidies. And I wanted to pick up on that because the OECD did some research a few years ago that found that fuel subsidies are the least effective form of support for fishers. So we're not only spending taxpayer money to fish down the ocean, threatening jobs and livelihoods, but we're not really even designing support in the best way for fishers. Now, you also asked me what the potential sort of benefits of fishery subsidy reform might be. So allow me to give you a little fact. Pew commissioned research with the University of California, Santa Barbara, trying to answer a question that perhaps wasn't answered 20 years ago, or even 15 or 5 years ago, which is, okay, so the theory tells us that support, this type of support is not working for fishers. But what would reform of fisheries subsidies really mean for the global ocean? Would it equal more fish in the sea? And in fact, the research shows us that if WTO members were to eliminate all harmful fisheries subsidies, now that's the most ambitious scenario possible, it could lead to a 12.5% increase in global fish biomass. That's 35 million metric tons of fish, or more than four times the annual consumption of fish in North America. And that's a conservative estimate. So I think I've given a good sense of what's at stake and what the potential benefits are, but I'd also like to add a sort of another point about what's at stake, because I think it's really important. And I'm sure that Ambassador Anzen will speak to this a little bit more. So I won't speak to the credibility of the WTO, but Alice, you mentioned in your opening remarks that, of course, this is a sustainable development goal, sustainable development goal 14, target 6. So what's also at stake is government's credibility to fight the climate and biodiversity crises and realities of the 21st century, coming good on promises that they've made to their citizens that they're going to tackle some of the biggest problems facing us. So not only UN SDG 14.6, but I also think it's worth mentioning, and you set me up because you mentioned fuel subsidies, so I'm going to pull that in again. Most recently at Glasgow at COP26, governments committed to phasing out inefficient fossil fuel subsidies. Here's a perfect opportunity to put those words into action. Like I said, least effective form of support for fishers. And you've got another mandate that says, look, we've got to phase these out. So governments have got to show that they're willing to walk the talk. So finally, I'll just end by saying civil society organizations, scientists, business, former leaders in the last few weeks are united in urging the WTO to harness WTO members to harness their political mandate to protect the health of the ocean and the well-being of society. And I think that's really important for when we talk about implementation. So I'll just leave you and anybody listening with the sort of last thought. And I'm pleased, forgive me if there are any negotiators on the line, because I obviously know that with the changing, unpredictable nature of the pandemic, you know, we're not sure exactly when MC12 will reconvene. So give me a little bit of sort of poetic license to say, if not now, and it may be March 2022 or later in 2022, if not now, when? When will there be a better moment for governments to reach an agreement to address harmful subsidies that are driving overfishing and threatening livelihoods and food security? There's not going to be a better moment with more momentum, but also more information. We've got the information that we need. Now's the time to reel in a deal. Thanks, Alice.
Super. No, thank you very much, Isabel. And I think, you know, I think one of the important things to particularly to take away is to remember that in many trade negotiations, the overall kind of gains of a particular trade agreement tend not to be terribly well defined. They tend to be quite general. They tend to accrue to some sectors and not others. You know, there's a whole sort of question around exactly what benefit trades bring and to whom. But the fact that a good solid agreement on fisheries subsidies would deliver 12% more fish biomass in the ocean for everyone, I think shows us just how valuable success could be, right? For the ocean, for fishing communities, for, you know, the huge amount of money that's invested in fishing already, right? So there's a really clear, really valuable win here for governments around the world. And I think, you know, many negotiators were probably very much looking forward to being able to talk about that win at the end of this week. So I suspect nobody is as frustrated as they are. Maybe we are as frustrated as they are with the delay. But, you know, this is the reality of life in a pandemic. But just remember, those of you on the line, over 90 of you, that 12% figure, right? Because this is the value that's on the table in this deal, at least. So with the sort of the scientific evidence well established on the table, Ambassador Anzen, I might turn to you. Thank you very much indeed for coming, and thank you for Sweden's support to all of this work. Can you give us, from the perspective of an ambassador to the WTO, how important do you think it is for the WTO to deliver on this agreement? Also in the context of the work that the WTO should be doing and should continue to do on trade and sustainability more generally, what's your perspective?
Thank you very much, Alice, for inviting us and having this webinar, although the MC12 was postponed this week. So thank you to IISD for organizing, and also thank you to Isabel for setting the scene this morning early from the US. First of all, I would like to emphasize Sweden's commitment to improve the health of our oceans, which is what we are talking about here today. And this was manifested when Sweden, together with Fiji, organized the UN conference in New York in June 2017. Already back then, it was truly a comprehensive and universal conference on the oceans. But the start of our engagement was much earlier than so. The very first UN conference on environment was held in Stockholm in 1972, and it will actually be celebrated next year at the Stockholm Plus 50 conference. And we are looking very much forward to continue this dialogue and on this very important topic. Relating to what I'm working with, the WTO, just to remind people that Sweden joined the GATT, the predecessor, in 1949, and it was transformed to the WTO 26 years ago. And we've gone from mainly focusing on reducing tariffs to non-tariff barriers or behind the border measures. But since a couple of years back, trade policy is not just about trade as such, but it's also about how goods and services have been produced or handled before being traded. There is an increased ethic aspect of trade, I would say. And as Dr. and DG Ngozi used to say, trade is about people. And people do care about how and what we are trading. So consequently, the WTO must take on board the concerns of the people. The ocean, coastal ecosystems, and inland water are vital for our planet and our people. Many poor and vulnerable are directly or indirectly dependent on fisheries. And most of us eat fish once, twice, or more than so a week. So from a food security perspective, it's hard to see that we can feed our estimated 8 billion people around the world without seafood today, and less so if we consider that we will be about 10 billion people by 2050. And feeding people will be even more difficult if we are degrading our marine ecosystems. So instead of helping our own existence and take care of our oceans, human activities are actually threatening the marine biodiversity, which could turn out to become a threat to our own very existence. So our oceans are not only a source of nutrition, as we heard Isabel saying, food security or income for hundreds of millions of people. Our oceans are also a litmus test of the state of our planet. Sustainability, sustainable trade, and sustainable fishing are interlinked. And this is why I would say the WTO have a central role to play for trade and sustainability. To end harmful fisheries subsidies within the WTO is the most single important contribution to this objective. The WTO agreed to eliminate illegal, unreported, and unregulated fishing, IUU, as we all know, to reverse the trend of overfished stocks, as Isabel just pinpointed. I would like you to take a break here and think of something. Illegal, unreported, and unregulated. Have you ever heard about illegal, unreported, unregulated banking or car manufacturing, construction, or illegal, unreported, unregulated hospitals? No, we haven't. But in fishing, it seems to be a concept, which for me is very strange. The IUU fishing accounts for 90%, if the numbers are right, of the worldwide reported value of catches. And that is one fifth. It's amazing, one fifth are illegal, unreported, unregulated. The IMO fishing severely affects the livelihood of fishermen and exacerbates poverty and food insecurity, as well as accuracy of fish stocks assessment. It is a serious threat to sustainable small-scale fisheries. It is equally important to ban subsidies contributing to overfishing and overcapacity. There should be the right incentives to ensure the move towards a non-harmful subsidies, and that's something the EU has been doing for 20 years. And the proposed hybrid approach in the negotiation links subsidies and sustainable management of fisheries. I know that this has been contested and not everybody agrees to it, but it's a concept that Sweden believe in. The fisheries negotiations were well underway ahead of MC12, as we saw, and they are actually continuing this week, and we will continue until the ministerial. The ocean respects no political boundaries, and only intergovernmental cooperation will ensure us to achieve the UN Sustainable Development Goal 14 to protect the ocean. And to end, Sweden is 100% committed to achieve a meaningful agreement, and we will continue to be so, banning harmful subsidies, increasing sustainable fish stocks around the world, honoring SDG 14.6. And this task was given to the WTO to sort out, and now the WTO member have to deliver. I thank you, and thank you.
No, thank you very much indeed, Ambassador. And thank you for just reminding us of what we're talking about. The IUU point, I think, was an extremely good one, right? I mean, we're talking here about the subsidies provided to fishing that is, in, you know, and in the construction of the treaty, determined to be illegal, unreported, or unregulated, right? And as many people said at the last ministerial, this should be a no-brainer. It should be a win-win. And the longer we take to finally craft these agreements, the longer we spend and the more we spend in public money supporting activities that actually don't benefit any of our fishing communities in the longer run. So thank you. I think those are really useful perspectives from inside the negotiations, so to speak. And I think both Isabel and Ambassador Anson have clearly explained to us all why we need to continue our work, right? Aiming to integrate sustainability and environmental matters into the universe of trade policy that those of us in Geneva are so familiar with. And I think this means that the importance of a fisheries subsidies deal comes from two perspectives, both from a systemic one that shows that the WTO can respond to some of these questions. In the case of multilateral subsidies rules, it's difficult to imagine anywhere else where these rules could be crafted, but also from a very practical side, right? The 12% of biomass that Isabel referred to, the ability to ensure the fish stocks that fishing communities, in particular very vulnerable ones, depend on are sustainable in the longer term. But as those of you in the trade community know very well, a deal doesn't deliver until it delivers. So here I might move then to the second part of the plenary session. I'm going to invite Gustav Brink to present the work that he's been so actively engaged in with us, creating this tool for developing countries to assess their readiness to implement a possible agreement and to clearly understand the remaining gaps or technical assistance needs that they might have. I'm then going to ask Maren Headley and Ambassador Anson to talk a little bit about kind of what they've heard and the value of technical assistance. And I should also note, and I forgot to mention this at the more earlier when I introduced everyone, but not only is Isabel joining us from an extremely early in the morning time zone, but so is Maren. So sincere thanks from our perspective to you, Maren, for joining us as well for this important conversation so early in your day. And I hope you get a slightly earlier end to your day to make up for it. So with the thanks pre-done, perhaps I'll hand the floor to you next, Gustav, to walk us through what the tool is starting to look like. Go ahead, please.
Thank you very much, Alice. Okay, I think we've got the presentation. I think what is very important is that the previous speakers have indicated why this is important. So what we're moving into now is how do we do that? And this is where this self-assessment tool comes in. What is important also to indicate is that if we look at WTO dispute settlement, the second most challenged agreement is the agreement on subsidies and countervailing measures, which just shows how difficult it is to regulate subsidies in a proper manner. And that then now spills over into the fisheries. So let's see how this works and what this checklist is and how this can assist you in meeting those obligations. If we go to the next slide. We have the self-assessment tool, which consists of essentially two separate documents. The first one is a checklist, which literally is, these are the questions that need to be answered, and you can tick them off. Yes, we have that, no, we don't. And then we have a guide that acts as an explanation as to how to complete that checklist. It's essentially been designed to support developing countries, which does not mean that developed countries cannot have a look at that as well. It may also assist them, but it really focuses on developing countries, including, of course, LDCs, in a number of key aspects. First of all, how to identify and collect the information that you need to know whether you can reach your obligations, conform to them, whether you can actually implement the agreement. Also to determine what your current level of compliance would be with the new rules, and how would you obtain and maintain full compliance if you're not there at the moment. And then lastly, but very importantly, is if we don't meet our current obligations and we have to somehow undertake certain steps to get there, but we cannot do it on our own, how would we do that? What technical assistance is available? We move on, we'll see that looking at the necessary information and data, both the checklist and the guide start with an overview of the information concerned. So in each section, and there are various sections, I think sections 2 through 8 specifically deal with obligations, and then we have a few more sections on general issues that are not reflected in the checklist. But so in the first 7 sections from 2 to 8, it really, we have an inventory list, we have then moving on to the specific obligations and so forth. Under the inventory list, we have 4 lists. The first one deals with all of the domestic fishery subsidies that you have that fall within the scope of the new rules. Now, bear in mind, especially for those people that haven't been party to the negotiations thus far, we're only looking at marine catch. So we're not looking at aquaculture, we're not looking at freshwater catch. So this is only marine catch. Secondly, who are the fleet receiving subsidies and what stocks do they fish? It's very important because there are a lot of questions, a lot of obligations in the agreement as to the specific stocks under that are being catched. Next, we have a table looking at the status of the fish stocks. Sorry, we're still on the previous slide. On the third bullet there, the status of the fish stocks identified as being fished. And then finally, in this introductory section, which is section 2, the vessels and the operators identified as having engaged in illegal, unreported and unregulated fishing subsidies. We'll come back to the IUU fishing a bit later. On the next slide, we'll see an example of what one of these tables look like. This is the very first table that we have in the tool. So table 2.2, a list of domestic fishery subsidies. We literally start with number, and it's a sequential number, subsidy number 1, number 2, number 3, and there are no prescriptions as to how you number that. What is the name of the program? What is it for? Who benefits from it? How much it's worth? And then on the right-hand side, you will see, not in such a dark blue, but shadowed in gray, we have quite a few questions, such as implemented to promote the rebuilding of a stock, et cetera. Those questions are specifically aimed to determine whether the subsidy that you have actually qualifies for one of the exemptions under the various articles of the agreement. So the fact that you have all these subsidies does not necessarily mean that you have to get rid of all of them, because quite a few of them may actually qualify for exemption in terms of the agreement. If we move on to the next slide and we look at what these checklists and guides look like, for each and every obligation, we have a separate section. So for instance, if we have an obligation, there would be 2 separate tables for that. We have a compliance table that indicates what each of these obligations are, how they work, what you need to do to assess your current level of compliance with that obligation, and it gives you a snapshot of what your current compliance is. Then, of course, if you meet that obligation in full, that's fine. If you don't, then you have another table, which is the implementation steps, which shows what steps you would need to take to meet full compliance. And that also includes a section again on technical assistance, which feeds back into the previous tables that we had. Now we're going to look on the next slide at IUU fishing specifically as one example. And of course, we could have chosen any other ones. Article 3 of the agreement deals with IUU fishing, but it contains four separate obligations. So it's not simply an obligation that you may not subsidize IUU fishing. There are different obligations. The first one is you may not subsidize IUU fishing. But you then have a separate obligation under Article 3.5 that says that what happens if a port state member informs you that it has clear evidence that one of your vessels that is currently in its port has engaged in IUU fishing. That's a separate obligation. There's also the obligation that you must have legislation preventing IUU subsidies or providing for the withdrawal or removal of such subsidies, and then a separate obligation that you actually have to notify that those subsidies to the committee and to the Committee on Subsidies and Countervailing Measures as well. Now, what the tool does is it takes each of these obligations separately. So you would have your obligations one by one with all of the different questions that relate to that. And then after that, you would have the implementation table for each of those obligations as well. The guide, in turn, explains each obligation. It reproduces the legal text, which means you don't have to have the text next to you or go to the back to see the annex. It will be in the annex as well, so you will have the full text there as well. But each time, with each table, you would have the necessary text so that everything is on one page, essentially. It gives you a detailed explanation on how to complete the compliance table, how to complete the implementation table, what you need to do, what is required to be able to complete the tables, and where do you find the information. So on the next slide, we'll see some of the sample questions that you would have. For instance, from the compliance table, the very first one, the question there is, does my government grant or maintain subsidies to vessels or operators that have been identified as having engaged in IUU fishing? The question goes on, and it then indicates the information that may assist you in making this determination. First of all, you refer back to your list of active subsidies, which you will find in Table 2.1. Then it deals with the subsidized fisheries and fleets, which you've already addressed in Table 2.2. Then it lists all the IUU determinations in the listed fisheries and fleet, which goes back to table 2.4. So what you will see is that all of these tables, where relevant, would cross-reference back to the information that you may have been providing in other areas of the tool. The next question that we have is from the implementation steps table. Do the domestic laws, regulations, or administrative procedures provide for this? So if we go to the next slides, we will see what this specific table, the question in the table, looks like. So from table 3.1, you'll see the considerations. The obligation is not to grant or maintain any IUU subsidies. What are the relevant articles from the agreement? So in this case, it's articles 3, 1, 2, 3, and 4. There's the question. I've already read that, so we're not going to repeat it. The information required, you see the way you can get that information. You will then indicate under evidence, what evidence do you have as regards the specific obligation? You would indicate whether you meet that obligation or not. If it doesn't apply to you, for instance, you don't have any such subsidies, then you don't have any further obligations and this prohibition does not apply to you. However, if you do have such subsidies, then it tells you what the next thing is that you should do. If we move to the next slide, we'll see exactly the same as regards the implementation steps, giving you the consideration, the question. Now you can see that what we looked at was already question 1B rather than question 1 specific 1A. Yes or no, do I meet it or don't I? What are your current procedures? What are your existing laws and regulations to ensure that you can remove the subsidy? And then what actions you still need to take to meet that obligation? And you will then spell out, these are the steps I still need to take. The guide will assist you in determining whether you can actually take all of those steps yourself or whether you have to identify any technical assistance capacity building, which you will indicate then in the final column. If we move to the next slide, which is essentially our last slide, just a very brief introduction as to how the guide works. It provides a detailed explanation in each instance on how to fill in the tables. And the same approach is taken both for obligations under other articles, such as overfish stocks, overfishing, overcapacity, notifications, and so on. For each obligation, we have a summary box, and it will always be highlighted in this light blue as you have here. It gives you what the requirement is, that it deals with articles 3.1 to 3.4, as well as 3.8, which is the exception on the IUU. It says that no member shall provide subsidies to a vessel or operator found to have engaged in IUU fishing based on affirmative determination by, and you have three separate affirmative determinations that could be made, either a coastal member, a flag state member, or by an RFMOA. And then if there are any special and differential treatment provisions, this is also indicated here. So in this case, developing country subsidies for low income, resource poor, and livelihood fishing, or for fishing-related activities within the 12 nautical baseline cannot be challenged. Now, this does not mean that those subsidies are legal or legitimate. It simply means that there's a period of 2 years during which those subsidies cannot be challenged. So all of the S&D provisions are dealt with in the same way. So the guide addresses the rest of the disciplines, including issues that are not obligations. It deals with technical assistance, institutional issues, both at the WTO and within the different member states. It has a brief introduction as to what dispute settlement is and how it works, and the peculiarities of fishery subsidies and dispute settlement, because it's a little bit different to the normal understanding on dispute settlement. And then separate from the checklist, because these are not obligations, it provides an overview of the specific provisions that relate to specifically LDCs on the one hand, and generally to S&DT treatment on the other. So that is a very brief introduction. I only had 10 minutes, but you're welcome to ask questions when we get to that part. Thank you very much, Alice.
Well, thank you very much to you indeed, Gustav. That was an excellent presentation. And I know that we have a number of negotiators on the line, so I hope that they were also interested in seeing exactly how this tool is evolving. And I guess for those of you who aren't as versed in exactly what the S&DT in Article 3.8 means, I think what to take away here is that after going through the checklist and making an effort to fill it in, governments, members of the WTO, will have an excellent overview of where they stand regarding the new disciplines, both regarding the subsidies they provide, but also understanding how much they know or don't know about the state of their fisheries, the stocks that they're fishing, and the behavior of the vessels flying their flag. And even more importantly, governments will know where the gaps are and how they can articulate what they need to help to fill them in terms of technical assistance. And this, in fact, goes to one of the questions that was in the chat, so I'll pull it in here. There was a question from Amerik Conry about the issue of availability of reliable information and data, right? So, and I think this is something we've been very conscious of, having worked in or alongside fisheries for a while. And our idea with this checklist is to help governments understand how much they know and how much they don't know, and then to be able to articulate to donors and to those who might be able to provide assistance where they need help to improve their understanding so they can get themselves into compliance with the new rules. So it's an excellent question, and one that we've been very conscious of as we went through this. So basically the idea is the tool will give governments clarity and a degree of confidence about how they implement the agreement and the ability to articulate what assistance they will need to do so. Important point to note, this is a tool that is constantly being updated as the new texts come out, right? So we had hoped to be able to do one final update at the end of this week with the final text. That's going to have to wait. But that is exactly the idea, is that at the end of the day, this checklist will reflect what is in the final treaty. So a small plug, if any of you on the line are interested in using the tool, or interested in funding the tool once it's finished, do let us know, because this is exactly the role that ISD would like to be playing in helping governments to make the final agreement actually live. So I'm going to stop talking now and invite some of our panelists to perhaps come in and give us some perspectives on this tool and the concept of technical assistance generally. And I might start with you, Marin. You've been very patient. Thank you for waiting at 3 o'clock in your morning. But having heard Gustav's presentation, we'd be really interested in your immediate reaction on the use of this sort of a tool for implementing a fisheries subsidies agreement. So go ahead, please.
Hi, good morning, everyone, and thanks for that presentation, which was very useful. And so we are an intergovernmental organization, and we represent 17 member states. We're all small, vulnerable economies, and most of us, 15 of us, are small island developing states. So this tool really allows us to streamline our information, and it places our fisheries in context in terms of quantities caught and actual value of subsidies. It will allow us to provide a baseline of existing information and current gaps. It's useful in identifying technical assistance and capacity building needs, in identifying data gaps such as biological data, what we need, economic data, monitoring, control, and surveillance data for the IUU fishing aspects. And it also provides a framework for linking the information, legislation, and policies related to the various articles in the agreement. And it's a very structured way to evaluate compliance with the agreement. And it can also be used to support science policy interface for fisheries management and subsidies fiscal policies. It also brings everything together in a holistic way, what resources are required in terms of human and financial resources, which agencies will need to be involved in implementing the agreement and assessing compliance. What are the current mechanisms for collaboration and compilation of the information at the governmental level, and what additional ones will be needed? For example, are there intersectoral committees that include people from trade or maritime, fisheries, and the legislative sectors? Or do these now need to be created? Do we need improved national databases to store all this information and make sure that everyone can access it at the national level? Another question it will help us to address is, what are the mechanisms for engaging with our FMOs, fisheries divisions, and the ministry under which they fall? They currently engage with the RFMOs, but how is information shared with, for example, the Ministry of Trade? How frequent is the information shared? Is it just on an ad hoc basis? And as you heard, it's also pivotal for helping us put the information together and in engaging with donors regarding technical assistance and capacity building for implementation of the agreement. So I, from a technical perspective, I support the tool. It's very useful, and thank you very much.
Thank you, Mara. That's very encouraging to those of us working on the tool. But also, I think that the fact that you're highlighting the coordination mechanisms element of it, I think, is crucial, because at the end of the day, this is what the agreement in practice is really going to require. It's exactly that. It's going to require the fisheries ministry to be able to talk to the trade ministry or the finance ministry, both probably, about how fisheries information is being linked into fiscal information and eventually into the notifications that go to the WTO, right? So another thing that's in the back of our minds as we put this together is, how can we structure it so that the information can easily be extracted from the checklist and turned into a notification with the minimum amount of burdensome person time possible. So that's all really encouraging. Ambassador Anson, perhaps I'll turn to you next. And we thought we'd invite you to comment on this because Sweden has an enormous amount of experience providing trade-related technical assistance. And we'd be really interested in the insights you might be able to provide from a donor's perspective about how useful this sort of self-assessment tool might be. Go ahead, please.
Thank you one more time, Alice. I would like to thank Gustav for his excellent presentation and also going into details of the tool and also the question posed by Marin. So I think we're getting closer to what I mentioned in my first intervention, the behind the border measures and the behind the border toolkits that we actually need. And just to one more time, thank you and IISD to do this work. And Sweden is very pleased to contribute to this work that you just presented, helping a developing country WTO members to assess their capacity to implement new obligations and to articulate the need of potential support. So this is crucial in everything we do in the WTO. And we're also looking forward to see this kit being finalized and utilized when the agreement is in place. So we're preparing ourselves to enter into force. Just to make a parallel, the EU has negotiated many free trade agreements the last 10 years. And one thing is negotiation. The second phase is implementation. And a couple of years after those FTAs has been put into place or into force, we noted that we needed something to follow up. So we've been focusing on implementing on the FTAs afterwards. And it's been a very important work. And Sweden has engaged the National Board of Trade in helping the Commission in the FTAs. And I think we are having the same discussion here, how to implement and how to make the different agreements that we are negotiating coming into force. Because as we just heard, there are many, many details that we have to look into and also monitoring data, etc. So we need instruments for that. And the new agreement to contribute to a global sustainable fisheries, we also need this tool to do it. We need strengthening and enhancing cooperation regionally across the borders and sectors and institutions is key to fighting the problems of the over-exploitation. So this could be helping this. So we're getting closer to this goal. Just to mention that since Sweden is very committed to not what you were discussing here today, but in general. So we also funding the FAO on its program to supporting development countries to ratify and implement the Port State Measures Agreement that prevents the IU fishing from entering, entering into the market, and to further strengthen and highlight the critical role of small scale fisheries in many low income countries. Sweden has also supported the voluntary guidelines for securing sustainable small scale fisheries. 4 out of 10 people in small scale fisheries are women. So fighting IU fishing would be a good contribution also for gender equality as well. So this proves that the importance of banning subsidies to the IU fishing without any exception. And we are happy that the negotiations are continue. The FAO also highlights that the implementation of fisheries management policies is widely accepted as a criteria for sustainable fisheries. To justify needs for special and differential treatment, that's another topic for developing countries, needs to be taken into account. I think I will stop here now. We can hear the comments from other participants. Thank you.
No, but thank you very much indeed, Ambassador. And I think it's important. And the fact that you bring up the FAO is another extremely important question in the overall design of the implementation of this agreement, right? And it's come up, I know, in the discussion already of whether there would be a specialized funding portal of some kind in the WTO and what the role of WTO coordinated assistance would be and how that would interact with the FAO. Because unlike something that is purely a change in tariff lines, which a tariff, which a trade ministry can do completely on its own. This, of course, is going to require, you know, some very subsidy-focused assistance and expertise, and some fisheries-focused assistance expertise. And the question, of course, is exactly how we should be coordinating that work, right? So the agreement is holistically implemented. The other thing I just wanted to say and make sure it's very clear in this discussion is that we're extremely grateful for Sweden's support, but this assistance, the checklist rather, is also being strongly supported by GIZ. So we're delighted to have their support as well as that of the Pew Charitable Trust. So it's really a sort of good consortium of people who are interested in making sure this agreement really has an effect afterwards, who are supporting this. So I wanted GIZ support to be registered too. But perhaps the last comment specifically on the toolkit that I thought I'd invite is from you, Isabel. And you've been following the work for a long time. But I wondered if you could tell us a little bit what role you see for civil society organizations once we get to the implementation phase of this work.
Yeah, thanks, Alice. And if I may, it's been incredibly useful to see that level of technical detail that Gustav's presentation. And I'd like and sort of the various points made by the ambassador, and Marin as well, and kind of the very sort of technical nature of implementation. So if I could be so bold as to take a step back before going into a bit more detail. As I said in my opening remarks, it's clear that ambitious subsidy reform really would lead to more fish in the sea. So that means better support for jobs, food security, and then of course the broader benefits of rebuilding fish populations and keeping the ocean healthy, for example, maintaining the ocean's ability, the ocean's resilience in the face of climate change. So effective and good faith implementation by developed and developing countries alike is absolutely critical. Members throughout the negotiations, developed and developed alike, have reiterated that they don't want to subsidize unsustainably and they don't want to subsidize harmfully. So that's, you know, that's a sentiment that has been reiterated time and time again. So while there might be some constructive, you know, ambiguity in the legal text, the implementation phase post an agreement, if members are able to reach an agreement, is the real life litmus test for the effectiveness of an agreement. And I think it's just worth stating that members can choose how to design their subsidy programs in response to an agreement, which I think has been kind of indicated here. And they can always go beyond the obligations encompassed within an agreement. This, you know, members can use the agreement as a sort of as a springboard to reforming their subsidy policy and programs to really ensure that they're better designing support for fishers. So I think, and this is where civil society comes in, there's, if an agreement is reached, it opens a door for tangible fisheries reform, fisheries subsidy reform as well, in countries all around the world. That could lead to better results for people and fish, more equity. For example, the ambassador touched on the issue of gender. There's also the issue of small-scale fisheries. And we've heard a lot over the years from small-scale fishers that they want to be better engaged in decisions about how to manage the resources. And they feel that they're not, you know, as included in those discussions. So this is where civil society can be really, really, really helpful. It's really important, is whether it's fishers or associations, whether it's business, whether scientists, they should leverage this opportunity that an agreement creates for dialogue, encourage dialogue with their governments. Now, with specific regard to LDCs and to developing countries, of course, SNDT is a mandate in the ministerial, part of the mandate in the ministerial declaration of MC11, and it's really critical for LDCs and for developing countries. And we, as Pew Charitable Trust, expect that flexibilities will allow developing countries to undertake commitments, you know, however gentle the time period might be, but not simply exclude them from doing so. And we know that the provision of support, both technical and financial, is absolutely crucial to that. So if I could just sort of close by saying that I kind of see three buckets in which civil society can support implementation. There's technical assistance to developing countries. So for example, the tool that we've been working closely with ISD and with GIZ and the Swedish government to create, that's one thing. But there's also there's a role for organizations like the FAO that we've mentioned, scientists' expertise in fisheries management and stock assessments. Then, of course, I think other speakers have touched on it, is this issue of coordination between the WTO and different bodies. And if I could just pull on one example, there's going to be a really important role for the WTO and RFMOs, regional fisheries management organizations, if an agreement is reached. And it'll be important for information sharing, but also for transparency and compliance. And, you know, there's a number of civil society organizations and nonprofit organizations like Pew, but many others, WWF, for example, that are regularly engaged in discussions at RFMOs. And there's a role for them to help ensure accountability, but also information sharing in those bodies. And then third, the broader need for demanding accountability and encouraging and engaging in stakeholder dialogue, you know, encouraging governments to engage in stakeholder dialogue. And I've already kind of touched on that, but I think here civil society organizations have a unique role to play. There's of course dialogue at the WTO, supporting and helping members, you know, in the discussions that are going to happen through the committee if there's an agreement, with national governments about reform in their country, donor governments, donor agencies, business. You know, business has shown, particularly the supply chain, and throughout the negotiations, that they want sustainable fisheries. They want to ensure that their fish that they're supplying to their consumer is not from IUU fishing, it is from sustainable fish stocks. And so there's a continued role for accountability, but also for continuing to demand that kind of gold standard. And then I think in this public sphere, you know, are we ensuring that public funds are being spent in the best way to support fishers and to support the environment? So if done properly with the input of various national stakeholders, I think we can, an agreement can effectively trigger not only subsidy reform, but also broader fisheries reform. And I think this is a really unique opportunity that's presented by a WTO fisheries subsidies agreement. And I hope that others will, you know, alongside us, we'll join in seizing this opportunity to really make a difference for people and for the ocean. Thanks, Alice.
No, thank you very much indeed, Isabel. And thank you for reminding us just of the interests of the private sector as well. And we've talked sort of in many of the webinars we've run about small scale fishers and their perspectives. We've also talked, as you say, exactly about the supply chain, large retailers who are buying fish and want to ensure that it is from sustainable sources, right? So a point that I can remember somebody from a large tuna retailers association made a couple of weeks ago, you know, is the market is moving here anyway, right? So subsidy reform, ensuring that you're not subsidizing illegal fishers, ensuring that when you provide subsidies, there's matched with effective management, is essentially also a strategy for ensuring market access, right? So ensuring that you are ensuring that your fisheries are sustainable and therefore you can sell your highly priced tuna or whatever it may be to other areas. Now, this has all been an extremely useful review, I think, not just of what's on the table in the fisheries negotiations, but how we prepare to implement this new treaty. We do have some time now for questions and discussion with the audience. So if you'd like to take the floor, please raise your hand so we can see you and you can have the camera and the spotlight on you if you wish. There were also two questions in the chat that I thought I'd address now, just while everybody gathers confidence. And the first was from Christian Haberley. Thank you for joining us, Christian, a longtime trade expert and part of the WTO family. And it's a good question. Is this tool available yet? Is it publicly? It isn't yet, essentially because it's still a work in progress. And, you know, it is constantly being refined as the treaty evolves. And also, frankly, because the work of designing a checklist and a guide that are both accurate in terms of the legal implications of the treaty, but also accessible to our average government official is not easy. And that's why we're so lucky to have Gustav and our friends at at MRAG in London, who are also helping with the fisheries management aspects. And in particular, my colleagues who are working really carefully to make sure it's right before it goes out. That said, one of the next phases that we'll move into early next year is having the tool reviewed. So if anyone on the line would like to read over the draft of the tool as a sort of sneak preview and tell us what you think, both in terms of its accuracy and its accessibility, please let us know, because we will be reaching out to people anyway, and it would be great to know who's already interested in seeing it. Now that applies to experts like Christian, but it also applies to any particularly developing country members who might be on the line, and I see there are a few amongst the 100 or so participants we have. If this sounds interesting, and if you'd like to have a kind of a walkthrough of the text and start to think, a walkthrough of the tool, the checklist and the guide, and to think through what it might mean for you once the agreement is finalized, do please let us know, because that's an important part of the review process for us, is making sure that we kind of pilot it in a very soft way, kind of walk it through with people who really work in developing country fishers and work with developing country subsidies policies. So we make sure it's a tool that's useful for them. So that's the long response to Christian's question. There's also a question from Ivan Sunshik, apologies if I'm mispronouncing your last name, but how would elimination of subsidies improve job availability? And this is an interesting one that I will have a go at just while I wait to see if there are other hands that come up. But this, you know, there's a kind of size of the pie and there's a distribution of the pie part of the response to that question. And overall, I think kind of the size of the pie question point is that if the reform of fisheries subsidies, and here we're not necessarily talking about the elimination of support to fishing communities, but it's reshaping so that it actually supports sustainable fisheries, to the extent that it helps to ensure that fishery activity is sustainable, what it does is that it not only ensures that jobs currently available remain available, but that they remain available in the long term, right? And this is one of the things, if you've seen some of the kind of the advocacy around this agreement, many of the perspectives that have been brought into the negotiations from West Africa, for example, speak very much to the fear and the vulnerability of small-scale West African fishers, because largely subsidized industrial fleets are making their own activities less sustainable. So there's a long-term sustainability of jobs question. Now there's also a distributional question. If subsidies mean a reduction in fishing effort in some areas, how are the people working in those fisheries going to be taken care of through the transition? And transition, I think, is the key word here, right? Because ISD has done a lot of work on subsidies, and one clear message that comes through all of our experience in subsidy reform is that you need a gradual transition. And you need to make sure that you're not cutting people's livelihoods off, right? Because it's not good policy in any respect, and it's also not politically feasible. So it's going to be a question of transition for different parts of the fishing sector, depending on how much subsidy reform needs to take place. So that's a long-winded response to that very good question. There's an interesting question in there about fuel subsidies, but I do also see a couple of hands up, so I'm going to give priority to the people who are brave enough to put their hands up, and then we'll keep some of the questions in the chat and make sure those can be answered afterwards. So I might perhaps give the question the floor now to Ayezu. Go ahead, please, and if you'd like to turn your camera on, we can make sure we can see you.
Okay.
We can hear you.
You can hear me. Yeah. My question is based on the fact that fishery subsidies, such as lorent tax on fuel for fishing vessels and reimbursements retroactively, storage and transport grants, ensuring fishing vessels do not pay license fee, could go a long way to encourage fish farming and eating of healthy protein for sustainable fisheries. How do we leverage on this as government and WTO to encourage the sector for the benefit of all stakeholders, such as the consumer, government, and the vessel owner? Because we're not just talking about consumer. Every policy should also think of the side of the government? Will it be beneficial to the government? Because most times subsidies could fall back and harm the government one way or the other while they're trying to subsidize.
No, I think that's an extremely important question. Go ahead.
How do we ensure that government is also benefiting from such subsidies, even as they subsidize for the consumer, the vessel owner?
And I think this is an important part of the holistic. I think what you're speaking to really is the importance of a holistic view of how we implement this agreement, right? Yes. So why is it that a government is subsidizing in the first place? And this is in fact one of the questions in the chat. What is it trying to achieve politically, economically? What is it trying to do with these subsidies? And is there a better way? Well, firstly, in terms of pure compliance with the agreement, is there any issue with the way it is currently subsidizing? There may be an issue, or there may not, according to the agreement, depending on what the obligations and the exceptions are. But there's also space for a separate conversation about whether those subsidies are really achieving the policy objectives set for them. And this is already work that IISD has done in Indonesia and in India, for example, to think about whether subsidies are really achieving the objectives. But it's a really important one, right? At the end of the day, these are government policies. What does the government want to see happen? And are these subsidies the best way of achieving that? So thanks, that's a super comment. I might give the floor next to Frank. Go ahead, Frank, please.
Yeah, good morning, Alice. Thank you very much, Frank from German Mission. Thanks for already mentioning GIZ, that is an active operator for Germany. I mean, indeed, they spend some money, but it is some money for the German government. And so you can see that over the last years, and it will be the same in future, we're active in the field and we are open for useful contributions. We need to see how that can be true in the field of WTO as well. I mean, first of all, we need a treaty, and then we need to see what is in that treaty. This is the very first requirement, and it's still not done yet. And then as it is a WTO treaty, it needs to be very focused what we do here. So if we talk about technical assistance in the field of fisheries at WTO, WTO needs to be very focused and concentrated work, because we have a lot of resources at FAO, and Germany is very active there. And we really hope that FAO will play a major part, whatever WTO does as well. And these partners really need to come together here. We do not need double work, you know, in the same field. And we really need to see what are the specific obligations coming from a WTO treaty. And to be honest, when you look at the drafts that we have seen this year, just in 2021, the obligations, they got less for especially developing countries. So we need to see what is finally in the treaty, still in the treaty, in the different fields, what is really necessary seen and coming out from that treaty. Because if you're not committed, or if you have no obligations under this treaty, I think we do not need special instruments in combination with that treaty. If there are those obligations, and if help is needed and useful, then of course that will be a topic to be discussed. And, yeah, we hope the best whenever MC12 is. I think we will need this kind of political moment as well to solve some final questions. As I see, the work is going on.
Well, thank you very much indeed, Frank. And thank you again for Germany's support to all of this work. And, you know, I guess the objective of the checklist and the guide, the toolkit in total, is precisely to make sure that developing countries have a good sense of what they are obliged to do and what they're not, right? So many of the tables that you saw in Gustav's slides had the kind of the vertical questions, precisely so that once a country has identified what subsidies it provides, it can start to identify whether it carries any obligations with respect to those subsidies, or whether it's exempted because it's less than a de minimis threshold, or because it's artisanal fishing, whatever the circumstance may be. So I think walking through the checklist will help to give a nuanced kind of case by case set of evidence about whether a country really needs to reform much or not. And if it does it need help to? We're 1 minute before the end. I know there were a couple of questions, I apologise, in the chat that we may not have gotten to. There was one from you, Ron, on fuel subsidies, a favourite topic for both of us. So I might, with your forbearance, offer to take that one up bilaterally because it's a fascinating one. But other than that, just before we close, a sincere thanks from ISD's perspective to all of our speakers. Marin and Isabel, thank you for getting up in the middle of your night. We really appreciate it. It would have been nice to have had you here in person, that would have been easier, but such is life. So thank you for getting up. Ambassador Anson, Gustav, thank you both very much indeed for your contributions. They were extremely helpful. And thank you to all of you, all 100 or so of you, who've joined us. It's, I think, the number of the people that we've had this morning is a testament to how important this issue is, not just for global sustainability and for the communities that depend on fisheries, but also for the WTO and the trade system in general. So thank you for demonstrating with your time that you think it's important too. And other than that, thank you all very much. And make sure that you're online again in 15 minutes for the next session of IISD's Trade and Sustainability Hub. So thank you very much, all of you.